To be here, I should say this is my very first Libre Graphics meeting and first time in Brussels. And my name is Christopher Adams, and I'm from Taiwan. And I'm in a little bit of a unique position within the publishing industry because I have the opportunity to edit books, design books, and then typeset the books myself. Whereas we normally see this complete division of labor within the publishing industry. Now, since this is my first time at Libre Graphics meeting, I thought I would actually start with something a little bit simple, maybe almost a introduction to fonts and what I would consider what you need to know in order to free your own typographic design. So I titled my talk, The Elements of Typographic Freedom, which is a play on a very well-known book called The Elements of Typographic Style by Robert Bringhurst. And while I don't assume to have his same knowledge of type history, I do consider myself a little bit of an amateur type historian, so I hope I can share some of my knowledge with you. I thought actually a better title after I came here might be Degrees of Typographic Freedom, since we normally talk about not elements of freedom, but a degree of freedom, meaning your freedom to change direction, your freedom of movement, in a way. And so I wanted to put together a little bit of a guide for font users, since I know a lot of people here, we're talking about software. We've talked a little bit about fonts, but we haven't really gone into detail about what makes a good free font and what are the free fonts that are available that you might want to look at. So before we look at the fonts, I thought I would might describe what these degrees of typographic freedom are, and I think there are a number of important ones. First is the freedom to own, and this means that the font is available or it's for sale. And in fact, there are quite a large number of even commercial fonts that are no longer available, either because the company has lost the license or it's been discontinued, or the designer just decided, actually, I don't really like the font and I don't want anybody to use it. So there are examples like this, such as the collection by Bitstream of the ITC fonts. These are now no longer available. You can't license them, can't buy them. And this is a bit of a problem. I mean, imagine if you had put your entire corporate identity based on one of these fonts, and all of a sudden it's off the market, and you'll have to change your identity, change all of your material and your collateral, and potentially be out a lot of money from that. So this freedom to own is one that is important for even normal graphic designers. We're not even talking about open source yet. The next freedom I would talk about is the freedom to use a font. And this is normally we think about a free font being something that's you don't have to pay for, you can download it. And some good examples of this are the Font Shop will give every month, they'll have some free fonts you can download. Storm Type has put out a font called Lido that's sort of like a Times New Roman, but doesn't suck. The next freedom is one actually that hits me a little bit more since I'm willing to pay for commercial fonts, and this is the freedom to embed. And normally this means PDF traditionally, but now with web fonts, it's becoming also an issue about embedding a font in a web page. And some of, for PDF, Adobe is quite liberal about this. You can embed, you can even embed your font in a commercial product, in an ebook or something, and it's no problem. FontFont, which is a very well-known foundry, is now offering some of their fonts sort of in web format. And now we're seeing a lot of this Typekit, things like this. We're able to buy that freedom to use the font the way we need it to get our products into in front of the eyes of our readers. The next freedom I think is a little bit interesting one. I call it the freedom to screen. The reason for this is because you can take a brilliantly engineered font and you can put it on a web page or put it on a PDF for someone to view and it looks terrible. And there's actually very few fonts that will perform on screen. Adobe is one company that thinks about this a lot, and actually Microsoft, too, has probably thought more about typography and has benefited more people with the fonts that they've put out, such as Georgia, Verdana, these sort of screen fonts that we know designed by Matthew Carter for them. But most foundries don't really think about this too much. Maybe with web fonts, they'll start to think about it more. But these are sort of just the use. A problem, though, is a lot of designers, they buy a font or they get one and they think, they discover finally it's missing something that they need. And so I think the freedom to extend the font is an important one. By extend, I just mean make some minor changes without changing the glyphs or anything like this. And this often means things like spacing, things like adding accents. Adobe also gives you the freedom to do this. And Paratype also is a foundry that allows this freedom. Sometimes you have to be careful about whether the foundry will allow you to change the font. And for those of you who are graphic designers, you know, well, there are other ways to introduce spacing modifications or to move accents just with your mouse to get them where you need them. But sometimes we'll find that a font is missing something more important, such as a character we need. And so in this case, we need the freedom to redraw the font, to actually get in there, to draw a new glyph, to draw a new character. And it's also the same thing. Adobe and Paratype are the few that actually allow us to do this. The problem is that you have to be capable of drawing a good letter. Otherwise, the end result might not be so good. But I think this is where these freedoms that I've talked about is where, for the commercial world, we sort of reach a limit of what we're allowed to do. The last freedom that I think we all believe in is the freedom to share. After you've made all these changes, defined the kind of font you need, you might want to be able to let others benefit from that. And it's really only with the open font license that we're, or other free licenses that we're allowed to do this. Google, as we saw this morning from Dave, is now on board and offering fonts under these liberal license, and the Open Font Library is also a place where you can get a chance to find fonts that are free to share and free to change. Now, it's always a little bit of a legal problem. Now, I mostly use commercial fonts for my work. Unfortunately, there's not quite enough in the open font field that is of professional quality, although the latter part of my presentation, I'll spend showing you which fonts are. So whenever I go on and I find a new font that I want and I click buy, I always have this moment of tension where I think, well, I better check the license first to see what I'm allowed to do. And this license we call the EULA, End User License Agreement. Well, what does EULA usually turn out to mean? You lose. But you should check the EULA before deciding to purchase a font to check the freedoms that I've outlined to see if you're allowed to do some of these certain things. You'd be surprised that a lot of foundries don't let you embed in a PDF, which is something that we feel like we need to do now in order to share our work. So I think this morning we got a bit of some preview of some free fonts. And I know this issue has come up a little bit about what does a free font mean. Now, we know if you ask a normal, everyday commercial graphic designer what is a free font, they'll probably go back to the first freedom, the second freedom that I mentioned about don't have to pay for it. But as we know, I think there are other more important freedoms. So I put together what I think are some of the best free fonts. Free as in they actually have all of the freedoms that I mentioned, including the freedom to share. And this is a little bit of a type history for all of us. So I think when the font that most people think of when they're talking about a free font is Droid from Ascender Core. And technically exemplary font. Well hinted, it works well on screen. It comes in a range of weights and styles. I'm only showing the sans, but there's also a serif. But from a designer's perspective, it kind of leaves something lacking. It's not really good for print or for identities. And it's just, you know, just not that convincing from a design perspective. Now, another font is PT Sans from Paratype. Also a little bit like Droid Sans in a way, but it offers a number of widths, a regular, narrow, and then a caption. And what the caption is for is actually they're giving you a design that works at a slightly different size than, let's say, the regular. And you can see the changes between the regular and the caption. We have slightly bolder. We have a slightly larger eye, the aperture, which just makes it more readable when we make it small. And so this is something that when I look as a designer, I say, there's a little bit more possibility for using this to solve some kind of design problem. I could even potentially think about, you know, doing a book with this.
Not that I would.
If I need a caption weight, then it's available for me. But this is just the beginning. One of the best fonts if you're looking to do a book is Charter by Bitstream. And the history of this font is a little bit interesting. Back in, I think, the late 90s, the early 90s, I guess. It was designed in 1987 by Matthew Carter, who's probably the best living font designer. And it was originally designed for low-resolution printers, which would make us think maybe it's not so good for today's technology. It was donated in 1992 to the X Consortium, which is a windowing system in Unix. And it has a number of features for book work. It's a very compact font. It has a pretty large X height, which, you know, allows you to, let's say, set it a little bit tighter in your line width, line height. And it's just a very sturdy, you know, overall good book font. So if you're thinking, I want to design a book using an open source font, then Bitstream Charter is probably your best bet. Since then, Bitstream has extended the font into OpenType, which the free version is not OpenType, including things that real book designers need, like old-style figures and small caps and ordinals. And unfortunately, these things are missing from the free version. So we can use it, but we're still missing a little bit of something. Because it was a free font, however, the font was extended by SIL International and it became Charis. And I'm going to switch back and forth between the two so you can see the changes that they made. Now you might think, well, not really much of a difference between those two. But this is a case, I think, where SIL did quite an important change to the font. And I think they undertook a very good example of what I would say, taking a free font and somehow making it better. What they've done is they've changed the spacing a little bit and extended it a little bit, and they've increased the weight just enough to make it really work well on today's printing technology. So if you want to look at a model of you know, how to do a good extension of a font, I think Charis is a good example of that. Now, SIL, we also know, another famous project from them is Gentium. And the purpose of this font was to create a very large character glyph coverage to cover multiple languages. And there's obviously all of the European languages using Latin alphabet. There's also a Greek. And this was just an extraordinarily successful design. It's very, very convincing. It's really well thought out. If you look at it, it's sort of based on a study of calligraphy. And it's a humanist face, which sort of means it looks like it was drawn a little bit. You can see sort of almost like the stroke of a pen made to produce these letters. It's quite solid. It's a quite robust face. And it's really indebted to a lot of the greatest type designers, such as Hermann Zapf and Robert Slimbach, Matthew Carter. And it does include a Greek, which I'm not showing here. But this would be a really great font if you need a good book face, also a large character coverage. And overall, really well thought out design. So the next font is actually by a real well-known font designer, Hermann Zapf. Maybe some of you have heard of him. This is Classico by URW, but it's actually Optima. It was renamed because URW was not allowed to use that name. Again, this was part of a font that was put into GhostScript, and it was just released as a PostScript font. And you can find OpenType versions, but unfortunately, it's missing a lot of the things we would really need to make it usable. However, I do say it's a very good design, and it's also a potential font to be extended in some way. Another design by Hermann Zapf was Palladio, also known as Palatino, under a different name. This was originally a foundry font designed in the early 1950s, went through quite a lot of evolution, and was also included in the GhostScript project. And we saw an example of it earlier today that it's been extended into many, many different projects. But if you're looking for a really classically designed font, this would be a good one. There is one more font that I don't have a slide for that's also from URW. It's called Nimbus Sans. And the reason I don't have a slide is because Nimbus Sans is Helvetica, and I don't use Helvetica ever. And neither should you. But another good design from Hermann Zapf is Euler from the American Mathematical Society. And this was an old font that was sort of included in LaTeX. It was based on the handwriting of a mathematician. And the interesting feature about it that makes it a little bit unique in open font, library of open fonts, is that it was designed at different point sizes. And so here's an example of the font at 5 point, 7 point, and 10 point. And you can see between these three that there are changes in the spacing. Well, when we put things at 5 point, it's quite small. It might be helpful to space out the font a little bit. But when we have something larger at 10 point, we can have a little bit finer details. We can tighten up the spacing a little bit. And this is something, a very interesting idea that is really missing from free fonts, this idea of having a font that is designed to be seen at a particular type size. This was through the entire history of type design. This was the way that it was done. You cut a letter at 6 point, it's supposed to be printed at 6 point. Or up to 72 point, and it's supposed to look that way. Well, maybe 10 point doesn't give us quite the range. What I'd like to see is this idea being taken up more by free font designers, because I think, especially as we go into web fonts and screen rendering, it's going to become essential to have designs that are meant to be seen at a particular size, and perhaps even within font formats and web fonts going forward, we'll need some kind of specification where the web browser will display the correct font depending upon the size at which it's being viewed. The next font I'm going to show is actually not a free font, but it uses a similar idea. And it's a multiple master font from Adobe, actually the original multiple master font. If any of you remember multiple master, it was sort of a modified PostScript format, except instead of having multiple fonts for, let's say, condensed or extended or thin or bold, we would have one design that includes basically all the designs across these axes. And what this allows us to do as a designer is we're not bound by what the foundry gives us. We can actually generate our own fonts for the correct width, the correct weight, and even for some designs, the correct size, not for Myriad, but for, let's say, Minion. You can choose a 6-point font or you can choose a 72-point font. Now, Adobe has basically given up this idea, and they've abandoned the technology. But it still works, and it's still usable in free software such as LaTeX. So that's sort of another freedom. And then I think, finally, I want to just mention two more fonts that are not for Latin, but for Greek, from the Greek Font Society. And they've put out a number of really excellent designs. Neo-Hellenic is quite famous design. When we look at it, we think it's sort of a sans serif, but actually Greek doesn't have this concept of a serif or a sans serif. But this was digitized by the Greek Font Society in early 90s, originally from design in 1927, and now it's available to us. And then another one from the Greek Font Society is Porson Greek. And this was originally designed in the turn of the 19th century, released by Monotype in 1913. And it's available from the Greek Font Society as well. So one more project I just want to show you, and then I'll wrap up, is a book that I... This is the first sort of free software book that I did, a photo book called Free Souls by Joey Ito. And I don't have time to get into it. I'm going to wrap up. But I was sort of left with this problem. This was all done in InDesign. And I had this problem of I needed to extend it. I needed to make it available on the web. And because it was locked in this proprietary format, you know, I had no way to share it with people. So I spent the time... you know, redoing the book, and this was all done in LaTeX, to make this something that was available to be shared, and also eventually will be, you know, an open source project that will let other people actually take the source files and do their own books from it. So I think I'll end here, and thank you very much.